Good morning, welcome everybody, and special welcome to Professor Jean Dalibard from Collège de France. And it's a great honor to have you here. So Professor Jean Dalibard not only has the chair of atoms and radiation at Collège de France, he's also professor at École Polytechnique and leads a research group in ultra-cold quantum matter at Laboratoire Casper Procel at École Normale Supérieure. So it's very nice that you could come here and give us this lecture on ultra-cold quantum gases, so thank you very much.
Thank you to you. And thank you to all of you for being here. I'm very happy for being able to speak in front of this audience. This is part, actually, of a Collège de France agreement between Lisbonne University and our institution. So I can start by saying just two words about Collège de France, which is, I think, a kind of a special institution in the international context. It's a place where, when you are a professor there, you don't have to teach so much. You have to teach something between 10 and 20 hours per year, which doesn't look much, sounds much. But actually, all lectures have to be new every year. So you have to prepare a new set of 10 to 20 hours of lectures every year for an audience with usually composed of specialists of the topics you are teaching. So every year you have to learn a topic and speak in front of people who already know a lot about the subject and so can be very critical. So it's a very big challenge to maintain yourself at the level of what you want to teach, which I said is a new topic every year. So part of our teaching can be done abroad, and so I'm very happy to be here within this framework. And I will speak about a kind of general subject here, which is ultra-cold quantum gases. So this is within the framework of this doctoral course on quantum information technology. And I think that, I hope I will convince you that these cold atom gases that I will discuss today are indeed very nice tools for this quantum information technology. So I will start very slowly, or slowly, I would say, and then I will go to more and more advanced topics. I would insist on the fact that you should not hesitate at all to stop me at any point and raise your hand and say that you didn't understand something or that you want me to explain in more detail. I mean, it's a sufficiently small audience that it can be a bit interactive. So please don't hesitate interrupting me. If I don't cover everything I've prepared, it's not a big problem. I prefer you to understand what I say than saying what I want, but without any feedback from the audience. Okay, so let me start with, as I said, something very simple that we all know, which is the fact that light has been first in the physical world a way to get information on matter. If you are an astronomer, you look at a star, and using light, you get information on the star, the composition of the star, the age of the star, how it will evolve in the future. This is true also for chemists, for example. If you want to know what is inside a piece of metal that has been given to you, the simplest thing to do is to put this piece of metal in a flame and look at the color of the flame. And immediately, if you're a good chemist, you can know that there is potassium, sodium, or whatever in the piece of metal I gave you. And this is used also for fireworks to give nice colors to this firework. The subject I would like to tackle today is a bit different. The subject that I would like to tackle today is whether we can use light to act on matter, not only to get information on matter, but to act on matter. And this is what I would like to cover. And by acting on matter, what I really mean is actually cooling matter. We all know that light can burn matter. When you get sunburn outside, and especially here, I'm sure you can get some big sunburn, then we know that light can bring heat on matter. This is not a surprise, and for me, it's not so interesting. What I'm more interested in today is using light not to heat, but to cool matter, which is much less obvious, and which, as you will see, can be very successful. So just to start with very basic things, the elementary process in matter-light interaction that we are going to use for having this light acting on matter is the notion of absorption of a photon or emission of a photon. So we all know that atoms have internal energy levels. So this is the energy level of the electrons around the atomic nucleus with a ground state and several excited states. And when I send light on such an atom, I can have some resonant processes. If the light has a good frequency, the atom can absorb a photon and say go from the ground electronic state to an excited state. and the photon is absorbed. The key point for what I will describe today is that when you have the absorption of such a photon, of course the atom gains the energy of the photon, but it also gains the momentum of the photon. The photon has a momentum h bar k, and when the atom absorbs the photon, it gets a velocity kick, which is simply the momentum of the photon h bar k divided by the mass of the atom. Now, if you take a standard atom, a sodium atom, you shine it with yellow light, which is the resonant light for sodium. Then, when you put the wavelengths of yellow light around 600 nanometers, you put the mass of the sodium atom, 23 times the atomic mass unit, then you get a recoil velocity, which is 3 centimeters per second. Okay? So, as such, it's a small velocity. If I take a room temperature vapor of sodium atom, the typical velocity are hundreds of meters per second. So a single photon absorption or emission is not going to change much the velocity of the atom. But the point is that we can repeat this exchange of momentum with a very high rate, and therefore, in spite of the smallness of an elementary change of velocity, because I can make several hundreds or several thousands of such exchange of momenta per second, then I can have a strong force on the atom, and this is what I will use to cool the atoms in a moment. Okay, so the force which results from this exchange of momenta between matter and light, when I simply use a plane wave, this force is called the radiation pressure force. This is not new at all. This force was actually discovered or invented by Kepler. Kepler wanted at that time to explain something which was a mysterious phenomena, which was the orientation of the comet tail with respect to the sun. When you have a comet which arrives in the solar system, so the sun is here, the comet is here, and it arrives like this, then you have a tail, and the tail is behind the comet. So it's a bit like a long hair in the wind. The long hair is floating behind the head. Okay, so the comet arrives close to the sun, it makes a fraction of turn here, and then it leaves again the solar system. And when the comet leaves the solar system, now the tail is in front of the comet. It's not anymore behind, but it's in front. And that was really mysterious at that time, and it was Kepler who understood how this can be by saying that the tail of the comet is made with dust particles which are extracted from the nucleus of the comet by the pressure of the light created by the sun, and then these small dust particles are accelerated by the light pressure. And with this force, with this light pressure force created by the sun, which is somewhere here, you understand that the tail of the comet is always opposing the sun with respect to the nucleus of the comet. We know now that Kepler's intuition was correct, but was only partial, because there are other causes for a comet tail, the solar wind, which is made by charged material particles. So it was only a partial explanation, but Kepler was right in the sense that this radiation pressure force does exist and does enter into the position of these tails. Now, we have in our labs something which is much more powerful to act on atoms than the sun, which are laser beams. With laser beams, we can produce a lot of resonant photons, photons which have just the proper wavelengths to make the resonant transition from the ground state to the excited state. And therefore, when you place an atom into such a resonant laser beam, you can have a very large radiation pressure force. The way to calculate this radiation pressure force, I can do it on the board. You have the atom, which I modeled by a two-level atom, a ground state G and excited state E. I send on this atom some photons with the momentum h bar k, and each time the atom absorbs a photon, it goes from the ground state G to the excited state E. And then when it is in the excited state, two things can happen. It can fall back either by stimulated emission or spontaneous emission. If it is a stimulated emission, then it's a bit boring, because at the absorption, the atom gained h bar k. When it makes a stimulated emission, it gives back h bar k, the same h bar k, so the momentum of the atom has not changed in a cycle absorption-stimulated emission. But now if I take a cycle absorption-spontaneous emission, the photon which is emitted spontaneously from the excited state goes in a random direction in space. So in average, there is no momentum carried away by the photon which is emitted spontaneously, because it's the same probability to go upwards or downwards or left and right. So in average, the momentum carried away by the spontaneous photon is zero, and therefore the net effect of this absorption spontaneous emission is the gain h bar k from the laser, which is always in the same direction. So then you get a force, and the force is simply a momentum h bar k times the rate at which the process occurs, which is limited only by the lifetime here of the excited state. So the force is within some numerical coefficient, so let me put approx, h bar k divided by tau excited, where tau excited is the lifetime of the excited state, which is something like, for sodium atom, 20 nanoseconds or so. So it's very short. So when you calculate the corresponding acceleration, so you divide the force by the mass, you get a large acceleration, 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 5, the acceleration of gravity. So the force that you can exert on an atom with a laser is 10,000 to 200,000 times larger than the weight of the atom. And therefore, with this force, you can do indeed a lot to atoms in order to cool them. To give some order of magnitude, if you take atoms which are going initially at a velocity which is on the order of 100 meters per second, which is a typical thermal velocity, with this acceleration, you can go down to 0 meters per second in a distance of only 1 centimeter. So in a distance of 1 centimeter, you can decelerate atoms from room temperature velocity to down to zero. So this is used in what we call in the lab optical molasses, which are composed of laser beams. And these laser beams are put in the following way. You take three pairs of laser beams, one pair along the x-axis, plus x minus x, one pair along y, plus y minus y, and one pair along z, plus z minus z. Each beam has a diameter of typically 1 or 2 centimeters. So at the intersection of these 6 laser beams inside your vacuum chamber, you have a volume on the order of a few centimeter cube. And in this volume, the atom feels the sum of the 6 radiation pressure forces. And if you do it cleverly, I will tell you what cleverly means in the next slide, then the force on an atom which is at rest is zero because all the forces balance. But if the atom moves, say moves towards the right, then there is a force which is opposed to the atomic velocity, which will damp the atomic velocity. So the force can be written F equals minus mv over tau. It's a damping force, exactly like the force you have. If you take a spoon in a pot of honey or a pot of molasses, you have a friction force which is very large. So here you have a friction force on the atom, which is a resultant of the 6 radiation pressure forces, which was mv over tau. And the tau here, the damping time for the atomic velocity, for the macroscopic velocity of the atom, is 100 microseconds here. So how does this cooling work? So the cooling that I'm going to explain is so-called Doppler cooling. I'm going to tell you how you get indeed this force when you sum these 6 forces here. The idea is to use a laser, which I said is resonant with the atom, but not exactly resonant. You take a laser which has a frequency which is slightly below the atomic resonance frequency. So in this drawing here, you see the orange arrow corresponding to the energy of the photon of the laser is not exactly enough to bring the atom from the ground to the excited state. So it can do it, but marginally. But thanks to Doppler effect, the absorption can be enhanced or reduced in a very specific and very useful way. Let me take a 1D model, but it can be generalized to the 3D X, Y, and Z that I showed at the previous slide easily. Let's take a 1D model and let's take so 2 waves, plus X, minus X, like this, and an atom moving along the X-axis. Suppose that the atom is moving towards the right. Then, because of the Doppler effect, if the atom moves towards the right, it will see the frequency of this wave and the frequency of that wave at a different value. The atom is going towards this wave. So it will see the frequency of this wave increased. When you have an object which is coming towards you, which emits some wave, say acoustic wave, you hear a sound which is higher. Think of the noise of a fast car passing by you. The noise is something like ning. So when it comes towards you, it's a sharp note, ning. And when it goes away from you, it's much more low frequency, ning. So here it's sharper. So it's closer to the atomic resonance. So this force is enhanced with respect to what you would get if the atom was at rest. On the contrary, this wave, which goes in the same direction as the atom, the force is decreased because the wave is less resonant. And so the balance between the two forces that I had for an atom at rest is not here anymore. And this force creates this wave creates a force which is larger than that one. So I have a force which is opposed to the atomic velocity. This is a friction force minus mv over tau that I was writing at the previous slide. Okay? And of course, if the atom was moving to the left, it would be the reverse process. This wave would create a larger force. Yes?
You are moving with the same speed here.
Excuse me?
What I want to ask you, you said that the atom is moving in the right direction.
Yes.
With the frequency increases. But the behind that wave we have, with the behind atom, which arrow shows, the wave which you have speed.
Yes.
More than the atom speed or the less than that?
Atoms may have the atoms are independent, so I have a collection of atoms. Some atoms, I have a vapor here, so some atoms are going to the right, some atoms are going to the left. What I'm saying is that the atoms which are going to the right will be more resonant with this wave, so they will see a force opposed to their motion. The atoms which are moving to the left will be more resonant with that one. So what I'm saying is true for a collection of atoms. Okay? I don't have to know the velocity of each atom. Each atom, depending on its velocity, will decide to interact more, physics will decide whether the atom interacts more with this wave or that wave, depending on its velocity. And it works in 3D when you sum all the three forces. So, as I said, we have a friction force which decreases the atomic velocity, irrespective of its direction, and therefore we reduce the thermal motion, so this is the cooling that we want. So indeed, light can cool matter, provided we are smart enough to achieve something like that. So just to give you an example, this is an old picture, but I think it tells you everything that we can do in the lab. How do we measure such low temperatures, or how do we check that we have cooled the atom? So you have here a schematic of a typical experiment. This one was done in the early 90s in our labs. That was one of the first optical molasses, but this is how we still operate nowadays. You take your 6 molasses beam, you have your little cloud of atom, and in order to measure the temperature of this cloud of atom that you have cooled with lasers, what you do is you simply let this atom fall by simply switching off all the 6 beams here. So the atom will fall, and as they fall, because they have some residual velocity, the temperature is not strictly zero, the cloud will expand. Okay? So what you really measure is the expansion as a function of time. This is a so-called time of flight method. You let the atom cloud expand freely for a given time, and you measure how big it is after a given time. And here we were measuring what was the time it takes for the atom, the time distribution it takes to fall from this height here down to a probe laser beam, where we were measuring the absorption of this probe laser beam. So the distance here was 70 millimeters, and when you look at the signal inside this probe laser, so first you have no signal, and then after a time of the order of 120 milliseconds, here you have a peak, and then you have no signal again. 120 milliseconds is no surprise. This is exactly the average time it takes for an atom or anything to fall under the gravity on a height of the order of 70 millimeters. If you take one half of gt squared, this is what you get. So the average value is not interesting. What is interesting is the width of this curve, because the width of this curve tells us something about the velocity distribution along the vertical axis. Some atoms were not at zero velocity, so some atoms had a velocity upwards, so they were going first upwards and then downwards, so those atoms arrive late. We had atoms which were going downwards, so those atoms arrive earlier than an atom at rest. So by looking at the width of this curve here, we can infer the temperature of the atom cloud. Okay? And when you do the math, you find out that the velocity distribution here corresponds to 1 centimeter per second width initially. And if you simply apply Boltzmann formula, 1/2 of n delta v squared equals 1/2 kbt, you find out that the temperature corresponding to a cloud like this is 2 microkelvin. Okay? So we started from room temperature atoms, and we cooled them down to 2 microkelvin. And the meaning of this temperature, I insist, is simply the kinetic temperature that you all learn when you learn the theory of an ideal gas using Boltzmann theory. Okay? So what does it mean to microkelvin? And first, what are the atoms that can be manipulated in this way? So let me start by the atom which can be manipulated in this way. So here you have, you have the periodic table, and the circle corresponds to all atoms which have been cooled by light so far. So you can see that many atoms have been cooled. All the columns of alkali atoms have been cooled, also those one, alkaline earth. Noble gas also have been cooled, and some more strange elements that you may have never heard of, about dysprosium or erbium or something like that. Essentially, in order to cool an atom, the only thing you need is a good laser. Okay? So if the laser is not, the laser source is not too expensive, so you can buy it with standard academic means, if you can make an atomic beam out of this atomic species, and then in principle, what I've discussed should work. So for the atom which have circles, we had some good lasers. When we say, I say we, it's a community, okay? No one has cooled all these atoms by himself, but these have been cooled in various labs. So because there were good lasers. If you take uranium, for example, uranium, it's in the far ultraviolet, so resonant fine, so it would be too difficult to cool uranium. So it has not been done so far. But maybe one day there will be a good laser for uranium, and again, uranium will also be cooled. Okay, so what now? Let me try to give you a feeling of what it means to have such low temperature. So here I have a temperature scale, a logarithmic temperature scale, over something like 16 orders of magnitude. We on Earth are here at around 300 Kelvin. On the North Pole, it's slightly below the equator, but on this scale, it's really marginal, the difference. The Sun is here. The surface of the Sun is 6,000 degrees. The center of the Sun is a bit more than 10 million degrees. So the Sun is here. You can say that cryogenic techniques start with liquid nitrogen, slightly below 100 Kelvin. Our cold atoms are here, between 10 to minus 6, as you have seen on the previous slide, down to 10 to minus 9. Kelvin, so it's nano-Kelvin, micro-Kelvin domain. In order to reach nano-Kelvin, we use laser cooling. In addition, we use also evaporative cooling. Evaporative cooling, I will not discuss it in detail, but it just amounts to the following thing. You first laser cool your system, so you have atoms which are already very cold, at micro-Kelvin temperature, and at a given stage, you put these atoms in a trap, in a box. I will discuss these traps later on. And you extract from this box the atom which have which are the most energetic. So, in a clever way. And when you have done that, so you evaporate a few atoms, but the one which have more energy than the mean, and then the remaining atoms have less energy than the mean, and they thermalize, but at lower temperature. So this is the idea of evaporative cooling, which takes the relay of laser cooling, the laser cooling that I discussed. So we are really low here. When you compare to standard liquid helium cryogenic tools, this liquid helium cryogenic is between 1 Kelvin and something like millikelvin. So here we are several orders of magnitude below. And in a sense, when you consider we on Earth here, we are notably closer to the Sun, surface of the Sun or center of the Sun, than we are from these cold atoms. Here you have more than 10 orders of magnitude between us and the cold atom systems, while the Sun is not so far from us on this logarithmic scale. So it's really a new domain of matter that is open when you study this kind of systems. Okay? So just a few landmarks in the history of these ultra-cold gases. I would say, from the experimental point of view, it all started in 1985 with the first atom which were stopped by laser light. And then, in something like 15 years, all the tools that we now use in the labs have been developed. The optical molasses that I just discussed and some neutral atom traps that I will discuss later on were developed soon after 1985. Then evaporative cooling technique was developed, first for hydrogen and then for alkali gases. Boson chain condensation was seen 20 years ago. And 4 years later, people could see degenerate atomic Fermi gases. So within 15 years or so, we had gone from the first atom stopped by light down to really quantum matter that I will discuss today. There have been Nobel Prizes awarded to this field, first for Chuk and Tanji and Phillips for the development of laser cooling techniques, then Cornell, Ketelai, Wyman for BEC, and also in the Nobel Prize of Serge Haroche and Dave Wineland. If I look at Dave Wineland's scientific production, Dave Wineland was at the origin of Doppler cooling for ions also. So in some sense, this is a Nobel Prize which is attached to the story of ultra-cold gases. Okay, so now after this presentation of this cold atom physics, I will split my talk in two parts. One will be about single atom physics. I would like to discuss atomic clocks, matter wave interferometry. And the second part will be about n-atom physics, collective behavior, and the notion of a possible universal quantum simulator. But now I can take questions. I mean, I've presented you with the tool that we are going to use for these two topics. But if you have questions on the tool itself, you are very welcome before I go to some applications, so to speak. Don't be shy. It's okay?
It was very, very clear.
Okay, well, thank you. Okay. So let me start with single atom physics. Why do we use ultra-cold systems for single atom physics? And the first thing I would like to discuss is atomic clocks, which is a technological tool, but also a very good tool for doing fundamental physics, as you will see. So first of all, what is an atomic clock? So you probably all have heard a bit about atomic clock, but let me put one slide in reminding you how it works. Until 1967, the time reference was astronomical, based on the rotation of the Earth. And then people developed some quartz system and realized that there were lots of irregularities, actually, in the way the Earth rotates around its axis. And it was decided to go to a reference which was much less fluctuating, which was an atomic reference. And at that time, since people knew how to manipulate microwaves, it was decided that the time reference, or frequency reference, would be the cesium. Cesium atom, the 133 isotope. And the cesium atom has two lower states, which are actually two hyperfine states of the ground electronic level, that I call here E1 and E2. And by definition of the unit of time, an electromagnetic wave which is resonant with this transition between the two ground states of the cesium atom, this electromagnetic wave performs 9,192,000,000 blah 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 oscillation per second. This is the definition of the second. If you have an electromagnetic wave which is resonant with this transition, you just count the oscillation, and when you have 9 billion and so on oscillation, 1 second has elapsed. Okay, this is the definition. How is this realized in practice? So the basic scheme for achieving that is to take a cesium atomic beam, say, put all atoms in the state one, send these atoms in an electromagnetic cavity, try to make the wave inside the electromagnetic wave inside this cavity as close as possible to this value. Then a fraction of the atom will have gone from level 1 to level 2. You detect whether the atoms are indeed in level 2, and then you make a feedback loop to maximize the number of atoms which have made the transition from 1 to 2. Okay? And then, if your feedback loop works well, you are sure that the wave which is here is as close as possible to this frequency, and therefore will give you your unit of time. You simply now have to count the oscillation of this wave to get your clock. Why are cold atoms interesting in this context? Well, there are many advantages in using cold atom sources for this. I will quote here just two of them, which are nearly obvious, but which give a very, very significant improvement, orders of magnitude. The first one is the reduction of Doppler shift. I have already mentioned this Doppler effect, the fact that when you move with respect to a source, you see the wave at a frequency which is different from what you would see if you were at rest. So when the atom move in an atomic clock, they see some frequency shifted wave, and therefore the precision of your clock is not good because all atoms have different velocities, so they all would lock to a different electromagnetic wave. So it creates a shift, a broadening, and if you have cold atoms, atoms which are nearly at rest, then of course there is Zhukov shift is much less reduced because the atoms move less, and that you eliminate some systematic uncertainty. Also, something which is quite clear is the consequence of the Fourier-Heisenberg inequality. The fact that when you have a given interaction time, then you can measure a frequency with a precision delta nu, which is limited by delta nu times interaction time is on the order of 1. You cannot do much better than that. So if your atoms are cold, they will move very slowly. So the interaction time will be much longer, and therefore delta nu can be much smaller, still fulfilling this inequality. So you can get much narrower resonant line with cold atoms. And this is indeed what has been implemented in many clocks. Here you have a picture of an atomic clock which was built with cold atoms by my colleagues André Clairon and Christophe Salomon. And the idea here is to have the optical molasses at the bottom here. They launch the atom inside this tube where they have the electromagnetic cavity. They launch the atom at a velocity on the order of 1 meter per second. And if you simply calculate how much it takes time to go up and down when you start with a velocity of 1 meter per second, you find out that the time is on the order of 1 second. So they have an interaction time which is on the order of 1 second with the atom as they go through the cavity and back. This gives a clock precision on the order of 10 to the minus 16, relative precision. Now, this looks like a very, very, very small number. To give you a better flavor, it's a clock which is such that if it had been operating since the Big Bang, it would have drifted from real time by less than 1 minute. So this is really excellent. And it's so excellent that you may ask, is it really useful to have such a good clock? I mean, do we care, really? And the answer is yes, actually. We care. We care both for applications and for fundamental physics. Applications are essentially navigation and positioning, GPS systems and so on. If you want to improve with respect to that, you have atomic clocks in all GPS satellites, but they are not so good. If you want to improve on that, and this is important for geodesy and things like that, then you need better clocks. And so there is really a demand from the industry and the services for having such a precision. Astronomers are asking for clocks at this precision. When you have very long baseline array telescopes, you want to synchronize the signal from various telescopes, and you need also very good clocks. And we as physicists also, we want these clocks. We want these clocks if we want to make some tests, some fundamental tests. Think of Einstein's general relativity, for example. What Einstein tells us is that if you have a clock, if you have two clocks at two different heights in a gravity field, they will not give the same time because of the redshift. The difference in frequency, relative difference, delta nu over nu, is gh over c squared. G is the acceleration of gravity. H is the height difference between the two clocks. C is the speed of light. Take h equal 1 meter, g equal 9.8 meters per second square, you get 10 to the minus 16. This is exactly the precision here. So with clocks at this level of precision, it tells you that if you put one clock on the table and one clock on the floor, the two clocks will not indicate the same time, and you will be able to measure the difference between these two clocks. So this really offers you the possibility to test general relativity in the labs over long periods. What is the future of these clocks? The first thing that I should mention is something which is a European project, so we should be always proud of what Europe can produce. This is the ACES mission. We aim at putting on the International Space Station a modulus here, which will have some cold atom clocks, and which will allow for a universal time reference. That is, it will allow us to compare the two atomic clocks located in two various places on the surface of the Earth, which for the moment is not possible. People know how to make clocks at the precision of 10 to the minus 16 in Europe, in the States, in Japan, but they don't know how to compare the clocks because they have no optical fibers between the two clocks, so they don't know how to compare it. With this clocks on the International Space Station, you will be able to compare clocks worldwide. And this will allow for something which is very important, which is relativistic geodesy. Just using the Einstein redshift that I was mentioning before, by having some very precise clock on ground, you will be able to record the motion of the surface of the Earth, and that's important both for mining and for detecting earthquake or predicting earthquake and things like that. So there are applications here for these very good clocks. Now, something that will probably occur in the near future is a change in the definition of the unit of time. I told you that in 67, people have chosen as a reference the cesium atom, with a reference in the microwave domain, with something like 10 to the 10 oscillation per second. Of course, since 1967, many progresses have been done, and we now have some very stable lasers in the visible domain. And the change that will be very probably made soon is to change the reference to some atomic line, but not anymore a line which is an hyperfine line, so at 10 to the 10, but a line in the visible domain, a line resonance line at 10 to the 15, 10 to the 15 Hertz, 10 to the 15 oscillation per second. The idea being simply that if you have more oscillation in a given time, you will have a much better precision for the clock. And this starts to work really well in some labs. So working with some optical line, there have been some optical clocks, as we call them. They are not yet the frequency standard, but you can still compare two optical clocks with respect to each other. There have been some optical clocks working with an instability at the level of 10 to minus 18 now. I mentioned 10 to minus 16 before. Now it's 10 to minus 18. So if you think of Einstein redshift, now it's your wrist watch, which is here, depending on whether you have your watch like this or like that, then you see a difference. Okay, so it's even more impressive. Okay, so that's the future of these clocks. And to finish with the clock, I would like to raise a question, which is another fundamental test that can be done with clocks, which I think is very intriguing, which is the question whether all these clocks, all these atomic clocks, give the same time. So it sounds a bit strange as a question, but I hope it will be clearer in 1 minute. Suppose that you have made two clocks, one with the cesium atom, this is the primary frequency standard, with this 9 billion and so oscillation per second, and you decide to make an atomic clock with rubidium atom. Okay, rubidium is the little brother of cesium, it's just above in the Mendeleev table. It also has a hyperfine splitting here. Simply, the splitting is 6.8 gigahertz instead of being 9.1 gigahertz. Okay, that's it. So in principle, if you make two clocks like this, you simply have to, if you want to compare the time given by this one and the time given by that one, you simply have to make a rule of three with the ratio E2 minus E1 for cesium divided by E'2 minus E'1 for rubidium. But now if you think a bit more, you say, okay, this ratio is a dimensionless number. Where does this dimensionless number come from? These atoms here are made out of electrons and protons. So in the end, this dimensionless number here is a function of some fundamental dimensionless constant, like the ratio between the proton mass and the electron mass, which is 1,836 and something, or the fine structure constant, E squared over H bar C, which is 1/137. Okay, these are dimensionless numbers, fundamental constant, and if you know mu and alpha, in principle, you can calculate this ratio. So now the question that you can raise with such high precision clock is, are these numbers, mu and alpha, really constant? Has the proton always been 1,800 times more heavy than the electron? Or does this ratio between MP and ME vary with time? I mean, it sounds like a crazy question, but as experimentalists, we have to raise this question. And Dirac, also as a theorist, raised this question a long time ago. And this high-precision clock offers the possibility precisely to test this possible drift of fundamental constant. So this is a figure that I extracted from a paper by Eckhard Pike and co-workers, where you have precisely the bounds that you can put nowadays on the relative drift of the fine structure constant, so alpha dot divided by alpha. The unit is 10 to minus 16 per year. You know why we have 10 to minus 16. That's precisely because this is the precision of the clock. Per year, because this is the duration, typical duration over which you compare two clocks. Here you have the same thing, but for the ratio mass of the proton divided by mass of the electron, again in units of 10 to the 16 per year. And by comparing, by taking various couples, you can get in this plane, alpha dot over alpha, mu dot over mu, you can get some bands like this. So this band, for example, the red one, is obtained by comparing two clocks, one with aluminium ion, one with mercury ion. And you can compare other things like that. And you find out that all these bands intersect together. And for the moment, they intersect together at a value which is compatible with zero and zero. So for the moment, it shifted, but by one standard deviation, so we cannot say. It's true, but if it was right on the center, you could think that the people have cheated a bit. We'll see. The good thing about that is you just have to wait. If you do the same thing in 10 years from now, you will have the ellipse will automatically shrink. So if it shrinks on itself like that, then we may not be at 1 sigma anymore, maybe we'll be at 3 sigma, and then we'll start to say, there may be something. Or maybe it will have shifted but also moved a bit, and then we don't have anything. But this is really an important thing to test whether or not these fundamental constants are drifting, and this is an outcome of this cold Lato clocks. Okay, are there any other comments on that? No? Okay, so let me continue, still with single atom physics. The second part, as I said, will be about many-body physics, but I would like to stay for a moment with single atom physics. And another aspect of this cold atom physics is matter wave interference. So this starts with Reid O'Broyle, 1923, who postulates that to each particle of matter moving with a velocity v, with a mass m, there is a wave which is associated, and the wavelength, lambda de Broglie, is h, Planck constant, divided by mv. Now, when you take atoms which are moving at a thermal velocity, again, I take the sodium atom, I take a temperature of 300 K, then at room temperature, the de Broglie wavelength is 0.2 angstrom. 0.2 angstrom is very small. The size of the atom itself is 1 angstrom, typically. So the wavelength is smaller than the atomic size. So it's very difficult at room temperature to see any effects related to the wave nature of atoms. I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm just saying it's very difficult. Now, if you cool the atom, if you reduce the velocity by 5 or 6 orders of magnitude, you will increase correspondingly the Broglie wavelengths, and then it will be much easier to see some interference effect. So typically with cold atoms, we have wavelengths which are between 300 and 1000 angstrom. We can even go higher than that. So it's nearly micrometer size, and so one can think of doing interferometers. What is a typical atom interferometer, and what is it good for? Well, here I have make a drawing of an atom interferometer that can be used to measure gravity. Gravity is downwards on my graph here. I suppose that I have a beam of very cold atom at a velocity of meter per second, not more, which is arriving like that. First, it encounters a beam splitter here. What is a beam splitter for atom? Well, it can be again light. I can stand on this atom a light beam like that, and I can arrange the parameters of the atom-light interaction such that the atom has a probability 1/2 of not doing anything and a probability 1/2 of making an absorption of a photon in the beam, in which case it gets a momentum kick, h bar k, as we have seen. So, and this is a current process. I assume I have no spontaneous emission if I choose well my parameters. So I have at the output two beams which are current with each other, one which was not deflected and one which was deflected due to some exchange of momenta with the laser. So here I have a trajectory which goes down. This one goes straight. Then I have an atomic mirror, which again can be done with light. Don't enter into the details. And at the output, I recombine these two paths and I measure what I get into one of the two outputs, say in B. So when you think about these two paths and you think about the what you will detect in B, when you sum the two paths, you have to take into account the phases on these two paths. And you can easily realize that what will create a difference between these two paths is the horizontal segment here. This horizontal segment, as when the atom travels along this segment, the upper one, the atom is slow because it's going slowly here, so it's still going slowly on this path. And then it gets accelerated under the effect of gravity, which is going downwards. Here, on the contrary, the atom is first accelerated, and then it goes, because it has been accelerated, its velocity is larger now on this segment. So when I compare the phase on this segment as to compared to this phase on that segment, because the velocity of the atom is not the same on this segment and on that segment, I have a phase difference when I recombine everything, and in this phase difference is encoded the value of gravity. So by measuring the phase difference here, I can measure the value of little g. It's very schematic, but at least you have an idea of how the gravity can emerge. And since it is an interferometric measurement, it can be very precise. The precision actually now for these interferometers, you will see an example in the next slide, is on the order of 1/1,000,000,000 of the Earth's gravity. That's a -9 g, which means that they are actually the best, the most sensitive gravimeter that can exist. This is called atom sensor. And this is useful, again, for geophysics, for mining. You want to measure the variation of little g at the surface of the Earth. And with that, you can indeed do it with an unprecedented precision. So this is, again, an example of experiment that was done in Paris by Franck Pereira and Arnaud Landragin. It looks a bit like the atom clock I've shown you before. It's, again, a tube in which the atoms are moving. And what you see here is the result over 24 hours, typically, of measurements done with this atom gravimeter. So here you have little g. So the unit is a microgal. So you can recognize, I don't think microgal is 10 to minus 8 meter per second square. You see it starts by 9.8, like we know for gravity. But it's a very small difference between these various peaks here. And what you see here are two types of results. The red points are obtained with this atom interferometer. The black points are obtained with a state-of-the-art standard gravimeter, which are simply some falling macroscopic object in a tube that you let fall and you measure how much time it takes for having the macroscopic mass to fall from the top to the bottom. And what you see is that, well, you see several things on this. First, you see that the two measurements, the black and the red, are compatible with each other. You can see that the gravity was varying in the lab here. The lab was close to Paris, and the gravity was varying. No surprise. This is also predicted by some models, which are in blue here. This is because of tides. Even when you are on the ground, you have tides. There are deformation of the crust of the Earth because of moon and sun. And so the gravity varies in the lab at the scale of 24 hours. So that's not a surprise. But what you can see also here is that the dispersion on the red point is much smaller than the dispersion on the black point, which is what I was telling you before, which is that the precision of this cold atom gravimeter is better than the precision of a state-of-the-art macroscopic gravimeter. Okay, so cold atoms are also good for that, for measuring gravity. And as I said, the precision is better than the 10 to minus 9 g. Actually, they hope to go to the low 10 to minus 10 g soon now. Last thing, and then I will stop this part on single atom physics. This last thing is about a place where you would not expect cold atoms or cold molecules contribute, but still they can give an important information, which is some fundamental symmetry or asymmetry between matter and antimatter. So for those of you who are not familiar with the subject, let me briefly introduce it. So I've spoken about atoms up to now, electrons and nuclei. We all know that the nuclei are composed by protons and neutrons, and we know that the protons and the neutrons are composed with quarks. And when you do experiments in high-energy physics, you have collision and you produce other particles also composed with quarks. And we have the standard model, which classes all these particles into families. It explains their mass. And we know also that it has a very spectacular predictive power. For example, the Higgs bosons was close to where it was expected, as we all know. Now, an essential ingredient of the standard model is the fact that to each particle we associate an antiparticle, which has the same mass and opposite charge. And we all know also that when we have a particle and antiparticle which meet, then they annihilate and the mass energy is transformed into radiation. Okay. And this has been observed and is currently observed in, for example, in all natural radioactive processes. So what is the problem here? The problem is this possible asymmetry between matter and antimatter. When you look at the universe, we do not detect any production of energy on a large scale that would be associated with a collision between large amounts of matter on the one hand and antimatter on the other hand. It seems that the visible universe is exclusively composed with matter. There is no antimatter at a significant level in the visible universe. And this is, as I understand, hardly compatible with the standard model itself. In the standard model, there are some slight asymmetry between matter and antimatter, but these asymmetries are much too small to explain why the visible universe is composed only of matter. We should observe much more antimatter than what we observe. And so there exists some more elaborate theories that break more strongly than the standard model the matter-antimatter symmetry. And this theory, so they break strongly this symmetry, so they explain why there is more matter than antimatter in the visible universe. But at the same time, these theories, like supersymmetry, to give it a name, these theories predict some new particles, supersymmetric particles, which are, people are looking for those particles at CERN, for example. This is a follow-up of the Higgs boson research. But also, these more elaborate theories beyond the standard model, have some prediction for our particles, so to speak, the one we have in our lab. For example, they predict that the electron might not be spherical. What do I mean by that? It means that the charge distribution of the electron might not be just with spherical symmetry. The electron should have, within this theory, should have some dipole moment. Okay? You should have not only a charge associated to the electron, but it should also have an electric dipole moment. The electron has a magnetic dipole moment associated to the spin. That's no problem. But within this theory, it should also have an electric dipole moment. And having an electric dipole moment is a violation of the T-symmetry, the symmetry between reversal time symmetry. So thanks to these new advances in atom manipulation or molecule manipulation, it's now possible to make very strong tests to check whether or not the electron has indeed an electric dipole moment. For this, you take some slow atoms, some slow molecule, you place them in some electric field, and you measure whether there is a shift of the energy level at a very high precision. The current upper limit is a collaboration of the East Coast of the US between Harvard and Yale and other groups. And the value they get is a bound, again, they didn't detect anything, a bit like for the drift of fundamental constant. It's a bound where that the electric dipole moment of the electron is smaller than 10 to the minus 28 electron centimeter. It may not tell you much, 10 to the minus 28, but in order to give you a flavor, people often speak of the classical radius of the electron. That is the radius you should give to a charge, a charge of 1.6 10 to the minus 19 coulomb. The radius you should give to the charge to have an energy, an electrostatic energy, equal to mc squared. So it gives you a flavor of what the, in classical physics, the radius of the electron should be, and this is on the order of 10 to the minus 13 centimeter. So you have a radius for the electron of 10 to the minus 13 centimeter, and you have a dipole moment of 10 to the minus 28. So it's a very, very small dipole moment, knowing that the electron has charge E. It's a very, very small dipole moment at the scale of this radius. To give a more image picture, if you take the electron with this classical radius and bring it at the size of the solar system, telling that the electric dipole moment is smaller than 10 to the minus 28 tells you that if there is a dipole moment, if there is a slight asymmetry of the distribution of charge, it is at the level of, it's smaller than the size of an hair. Okay, so you take the size of the solar system, scaling the radius of the electron, and you put an hair in one direction of this sphere corresponding to the solar system, and that would be 10 to the minus 28 electron centimeter. Okay, so we can say for the moment that the electron is spherical at this level, one air compared to the size of the solar system. And of course, if we were able to detect some non-zero value here with a good confidence, that would be a major event in physics, because it would be a validation of these theories that are used, that people would like to use to explain the matter-antimatter symmetry in the universe. So it's interesting to see how physics, which is done on table in a lab with high precision, can bring some information on something which has the macroscopic scale like the universe. Okay, so this ends what I wanted to say on the first major part of the talk, which was about this single atom physics. And now I would like to go to an atom physics. Now I would like to go to the second part of the talk, which is related to quantum collective effects. And these effects will appear when the gas is dense enough, so it's not anymore a single atom that I'm interested in, but it's a collection of atoms, and a collection of atoms which is dense at this, within this criterion, that is the interparticle distance d, becomes smaller, or on the order of the de Broglie wavelengths, lambda de Broglie, that I already introduced. And these experiments can be done either with bosons. Here I've listed some bosons, lithium, potassium, ytterbium, with isotope 7, 39, and or with fermions, lithium 6, potassium 40. Just a word about what causes an atom to be a fermion or a boson. So I suppose you all know what do you need to be a boson? Spin? Integer. Okay, good. So why would lithium 6 be a fermion and lithium 7 be a boson? So you have to realize that all the atoms that we are using are neutral. Okay, so the atoms have some electron, some proton, and some neutron. Because they are neutral, the number of electrons and the number of proton is always the same. So this number can be even or odd. This number can be even or odd. But when I sum the two, I always get something which is even. So this will always give me an even number of particles of spin 1/2. So with that, I always have an integer spin, so to speak. So it's really the number of neutrons, whether it's even or odd, which will decide whether my atom is a fermion or a boson. Because of the electric neutrality, the proton and the neutron do not enter into the game. It's the number of neutrons. So if you take lithium, for example, lithium 6, you have 3, 3, and 3. This is 6 lithium. Whereas lithium 7, here it's a 4. So this will be a fermion, because in the end I have an odd number, total odd number of particle one, spin 1/2. 3 plus 3 plus 3, 9. Whereas here I have an even number of particle 1/2. 3 plus 3 plus 4, 10. Okay? So we, depending on the isotope we choose, and this we can do by tuning finally the wavelengths of our laser in the experiment, we can experiment, if we have quantum with lithium, we can experiment with a boson or with a fermion. Okay, I will speak mostly about bosons today, but there will be a few slides about fermions still. So we are going to look for quantum physics at the macroscopic scale, and the first thing I should say is that it's not the first time, of course, and people are looking at this quantum matter. Here I've put two examples which were discovered at the beginning of the 20th century. Superfluid helium on the one hand, electrical superconductivity on the other hand, are phenomena which are due to quantum mechanics at the macroscopic scale. So what we are observing with our cold atom system is a third kind of macroscopic quantum matter, but it's within the same general framework. Now I start with maybe the most spectacular thing that can be seen, which is Bose-Einstein condensation. And what is quite remarkable about Bose-Einstein condensation is that it exists for an ideal gas. It is, to my knowledge, the only phase transition that exists in nature without interaction between particles. When water turns into ice at 0°C, it's because you have interactions between the water molecules. Okay? And most of the phase transitions that you can think of, magnets and so on, they are due to interaction between particles. Here, when you think of Bose-Einstein condensation, this is a phase transition which is due only to the way of counting the particles, to quantum statistics. So it was discovered essentially by Einstein in 1924, and the cartoon picture of boson chain condensation is the following. You start with a gas which is at a relatively large temperature, so you can view the atom like little wave packet with a short wavelength because the atoms are moving fast. When you cool the atom, the wavelength increases. We went into that. And when the wavelength lambda is on the order of the interparticle distance, there is this phase transition which occurs, which corresponds to macroscopic accumulation of particles in the ground state of the box confining the particle. And when you cool even more for an ideal gas, you can put all the atoms in the state, in the ground state of the box. So at T equals zero, you prepare a giant micro matter wave. All the atoms are in the same wave, exactly as all the photons of this pointer are in the same state, same wave vector, same color. So this is an example made with rubidium 87. So again, this little game about numbers of protons and electrons. So you have 37 protons, 37 electrons, which give you this integer spin plus 50 neutrons, again integer. So it's indeed a boson. And what you see in the lab when you look for boson chain condensation is typically that. Here you go from a hot cloud to a cold cloud. When I say hot, this is, say, 2 microkelvin, and this is 1 microkelvin. Okay, so it's hot in our language, but it's still very cold. But this is non-condensed, and this is condensed. And what you see here is something quite remarkable, which was in the smoking gun for boson chain condensation, like it was discovered in 1995, which is what happens when you confine your atoms in two traps, which is not isotropic. So let me explain this a little bit. The atoms here are confined in a magnetic trap. So I will not enter in the details of a magnetic trap, but let me simply say that the atoms have a magnetic moment, so they interact with external magnetic field, and there are some configuration of magnetic field such that the force resulting from the interaction of the magnetic moment with the external field creates a restoring force toward the center of your system. So inside your vacuum chamber, you have a little trap like this, and the atom can accumulate thanks to the magnetic moment. Now, this trap is anisotropic. That is, it doesn't have the same frequency, same oscillation frequency along the axis X and the axis Y. Okay, the two frequencies are different. Now, when the gas is not condensed here, okay, it's well described by Maxwell's Boltzmann statistics, and even though the trap is not isotropic, the velocity distribution along X and Y is the same. That is, 1 half of m Vx squared average is equal to 1 half of m Vy squared average equal 1 half of kBt. This is the relation I already used, which I'm saying here. So the trap may be anisotropic. It can create some anisotropic distribution in steady state. But if I measure the velocities, I will find the same velocity distribution on x and y. And this is precisely what has been done here. This is a velocity distribution. That is, this is a time of flight measurement exactly in the same spirit of what I already discussed. Here we have cut the trap, and we have let the cloud expand. And after having the cloud expanding, we took a picture. And the cloud expand in a spherical manner, even though the initial distribution, which is much smaller on this scale, even though this initial distribution was anisotropic. Now, when we cool the system accumulates in the ground state of the trap. This is the idea of boson chain condensation. And the ground state of the trap is anisotropic, because the trap itself is anisotropic. So when we cool the cloud in the ground state of the trap, because the frequency along x, omega x, is different from the frequency along y, when the atom accumulates in the ground state of the trap, then the 1 half of m vx squared is equal to 1 fourth of h bar omega x in the ground state. 1 half of m vy squared is equal to 1 fourth of h bar omega y. All these are, of course, averages. And now, when the atom are in the ground state of the trap, the velocity distribution along x is not the same as the velocity distribution along y. There is a difference. The ratio is simply the ratio between omega x and omega y. So when you cross the phase transition point, then you see an asymmetric velocity distribution. And this is a smoking gun for atoms accumulating in the ground state of the trap. And when you push the evaporation further, you see only this anisotropic distribution, which is here, which reveals the existence of macroscopic distribution. So Bose-Einstein condensation had been looked for a long time without being seen, and when it was seen in, first by the Boulder group, this anisotropy which was appearing when you cooled the system was really something which convinced everyone immediately. Okay, so we have this macroscopic matter wave, which is, as I said, can be understood with an ideal gas, like an ideal gas phenomenon. So this is very nice. It's a confirmation of the prediction by Einstein. Many atoms have been Bose condensed. You have here the list. Now, why is it so interesting? Why are there so many labs working worldwide on these topics? I would say the main reason is that actually, even though the atoms are can be considered as non-interacting before they condense, once they've condensed, the interactions play a very important role. And this is because there are interactions between the atoms that actually the system is interesting. This is the interaction which makes the system non-trivial. But the good thing about these interactions is that they are important, but they are also simple to handle, at least at the mean field level. Why is it so? Well, when you think of the interaction potential between two atoms, say two rubidium atoms, in principle, this is something which is quite complicated. Here I have plotted this interaction potential as a function of distance. So at very long distance, here you have some van der Waals forces which attract two atoms together. So R here is the distance between a pair of atoms. Then you have the interaction is even stronger because this is a force which creates a chemical bound. And then when the distance is too close, then the two electronic clouds start to overlap, and then the atoms repel each other. So this potential is very complicated. Actually, it's not so well known even for atoms which are relatively simple. So if we had to know all the details of this potential, we would be in trouble. But fortunately, we are at a very low temperature. Our system is very cold. We have a thermal wavelength which is on the order of a micrometer, whereas the scale of this potential is a nanometer. So in a sense, we can say that the atoms do not feel the details of this potential. They simply feel an average of this potential. When I say average, it's a bit loose as a way of speaking, but still it conveys the idea. The wavelength of the atom is so large that the atom will replace the potential by something much simpler. This something much simpler is the so-called scattering length. That is, when you are at such low temperature, so large the wavelength, and if you want to make an accurate description of the collision between the atoms, you will write the scattering state of the two atoms colliding with each other. K here is the relative momentum between the two atoms, and the scattering state is the sum of the incident plane wave, the two atoms in the center of mass coming like that, so this is this e to the ikr, plus a spherical wave. It is spherical because it's just so-called S-wave scattering. All the other partial waves, for those of you who are familiar, do not play a role at this low temperature. So it's a spherical outgoing wave, e to the ikr over r. And the scattering amplitude f of k depends only on the modulus of the wave vector, relative wave vector of the two atoms. This f of k depends on a single number, which is a so-called scattering length, as. So it's minus as over 1 plus iks. So if you know AS, if you know the scattering length, you know everything you need for describing the collision between these two atoms at low temperature. This is what, when I was speaking about an average of the potential, this is what I meant. Knowing only AS is enough for most of you need to describe the many body aspects of this problem. So if you take two potentials which have the same scattering lengths, they will have a similar effect on the ultra cold gas. So don't care about what the detail of this potential. AS can be positive or negative. That depends on the pairs of atoms that you take. If AS is positive, it means that the interaction between the atoms are effectively repulsive. Whereas if AS is negative, it means that the interactions are attractive. And something which is even better, major advantage of using these, of playing with these cold atom systems, is that at least for some species, you can tune the sign and the magnitude of AS. That is, you can play with scattering resonances, which are usually monitored by changing the ambient magnetic field in the experiment. And by changing the magnetic field, you change the value of AS, and you can, as I say, even change the sign. That is, you have a knob in the lab which allows you to go from a a gas which is effectively repulsive to a gas which is effectively attractive. So this is really something that you could not do with other type of quantum matter, say liquid helium, for example. Okay, so let me simply give you one example of how this can be used to address some fundamental problem. And here I'm going to speak about fermions. So this is a slide about fermions. You use again this scattering amplitude. You take a two-component Fermi gas. So you take spin-up and spin-down particle in your gas. Can be lithium 6, for example, potassium 40. So you place these atoms in together, these two spin states together. They interact together with this scattering amplitude, and you have the knob to adjust AS. So you can take AS equals 0, but AS equals 0 means no interaction, no scattering amplitude. This is kind of boring because, again, we are back to the ideal gas, which is fine to test that Einstein was correct or that Fermi was correct, but it's a limited thing. But you can also tune AS to infinity, okay? And that's becoming much more interesting. What does it mean to take AS to infinity? You could think that everything is going to diverge, but no. If you take AS to infinity into this formula, it simply tells you that you have the strongest interaction possible between your particle, and then the scattering amplitude is simply I over K. This is the strongest interaction between particles, which is allowed by quantum mechanics, I over K. So it's a universal problem. You take a spin one half system, you make it interact as strongly as possible as allowed by quantum mechanics, scattering amplitude I over K. What are the properties of this system? So again, it's a universal question. A good way to see that it's universal is that then you have no length scale associated to interactions. The length scale associated to interaction is AS, or you can say you have an energy scale, which is h bar square over MAS. In quantum mechanics, when you have a length scale, you have an energy scale. But here, because AS has gone to infinity, there is no length scale, no energy scale associated to interaction, so it's a universal problem. Okay? And a way to show that it's a universal problem is to say, okay, let's calculate the ground state energy density of this system with this infinite scattering length. This energy density epsilon can be written, because we have no length scale associated to interaction, can be written as a function of the ground state energy density for the ideal gas, so it depends only on the density of the system, times some number, xi. And this number, xi, is a universal number. Okay? But this universal number was not known when these experiments were started to be done. Actually, when I say it was not known, it was known by theorists, but the theorists did not agree with each other. So it was known to someone, it was known to another person, but it was not the same knowledge. Okay? So it was a typical universal problem, easy to formulate, but hard to give the answer. And then the experiment had been done in various labs. The experimentalists did not agree also with each other at the beginning, but now they all agree with each other. The theorists all agree with the experimental results, and the final number, which is known since 2 or 3 years now, is 0.37. So if you are asked about the value of this so-called Birch parameter, it's 0.37. And this is relevant for many other systems now, because I said it's a universal problem. So in particular, it's directly relevant for neutron matter in the outer crust of neutron stars, where it's believed to be close to this system. So the neutron-neutron interaction is close to be universal in this respect. Okay, so I like this example because I think it's the first example of a kind of quantum simulator. Quantum simulator in the sense that we had a question which was a simple question. It was not a system-dependent question. It was a universal question that could be formulated very generally, valid for neutron matter as well as for cold atoms. But you could think of many other systems where you can address this question of unitary interaction, as we call it. And the cold atom system, by experiments, could give the answer 0.37. That's it. Okay? So this brings me to this idea of a quantum simulation. This is really following Feynman's idea in his famous paper of 1982, which is, instead of trying to solve a problem on a computer when it is too hard, instead of solving it on a computer, you use another system, which is here the cold atom fluid, to solve the problem. The idea of a simulator is not new. It was used in classical world quite often, and a nice example are the astronomical clocks that were built in the Middle Ages. for predicting some events like solar eclipse or lunar moon eclipse. Those were difficult to calculate at that time. And instead of calculating them, you could make an astronomical clock with a very precise engineering of the motion of the planets and the sun and the moon. And in this way, but simply by looking how the astronomical clocks run, you could predict some of these events. Okay? So the idea of mimicking nature with another system instead of calculating is not new. But the point of Feynman in 1982 was the fact that nature was not classical. We all know that. And if you want to make a simulation of nature, you'd better to make this simulation quantum mechanical. And this is where the cold atom system comes, that it can be a good quantum simulator. So what do you need for a good quantum simulator? So here I have made a list of things that you would need. And we are going to go through this list and see whether or not we can address these various items. So first of all, you should be able to use bosons or fermions, because the question that you may raise in quantum mechanics, in many-body quantum mechanics, can be either for bosons or fermions, but this we know we can do. You have to be able to tune the various energies. You should be able to tune the interaction energy with respect to kinetic energy, essentially. And this also, we just saw that it's possible, at least for some species, using these scattering resonances. So these two things we have already seen. You should be able to tune the dimensionality and also the potential landscape in which your particle evolves. I mentioned the harmonic potential on the board here, but you should be able to mimic periodic potential if you want to mimic the motion of electrons in a solid. You should be able to make boxes, uniform boxes, disorder. You will see that all this can be done thanks to laser beam. And finally, you should also be able to mimic magnetism. By magnetism, I mean what happens when you put an electron in a magnetic field. You have a Lorentz force, QV cross B, and because of this Lorentz force, in the quantum world, you have the quantum Hall effect. Now, our atoms do not have a charge, Q is zero, so are we able to mimic magnetism? You will see that the answer is yes, provided you play some tricks. So I would like to spend the rest of the lecture on these two topics here. But if there are questions, again, I can take them now if there are questions on the previous slides. No? Okay. So let's go to this. And let me start with the periodic potential. Okay. Harmonic you have seen, so let me start with periodic. How do we do periodic potential with atoms? So the idea is to do so-called optical lattices. Many of you have probably heard about that. An optical lattice is something which is very simple. It is simply a standing wave of light. Okay, so nothing mysterious. It's called an optical lattice because it's optical, made with light, and the lattice because it's periodic, but it's just a standing wave of light. So you shine simply, if you want to make a 2D optical lattice, you shine two lasers along this direction, two lasers along that direction. They make a node, stem of node and antinode. And if you choose your wavelengths correctly, you can arrange the system so that the atoms accumulate at the nodes of the intensity pattern. So what you really have is a kind of egg box for atoms like this, where you would have atoms on this trapped at the nodes of the standing wave. So what is the force trapping the atoms? Let me explain this force in one slide. I already explained the radiation pressure force, the force of Kepler, okay, the one which was pushing the atom in a plane running wave. Now we need a second force, the so-called dipole force, deriving from the dipole potential, which is present not in a plane wave, but in a wave where you have a gradient of intensity, which is the case. If I have a standing wave, I have gradient of intensity with node and antinodes. So how do I understand this dipole potential? Actually, it's quite simple. The way the atom interacts with the light field is just by electric dipole interaction. So I have a dipole operator for the atom D. I have the laser electric field, E laser here, and the interaction potential is minus the dipole operator times the electric field, which is what I have applied with my laser. Now, if the laser light is not too intense, which is what I will assume in the following, I can use linear response theory. And when I calculate the average value of the dipole operator, steady state, I get something which is proportional to the laser with some polarizability alpha here. This polarizability alpha can be negative if the frequency of the light is above the atomic resonance. So if I am on the blue of the atomic resonance, then alpha is negative. If I am on the red of the atomic resonance, if the frequency of the light is below the atomic resonance frequency, then alpha is positive. So I can, depending on the wavelengths of the lasers that I choose, alpha can be positive or negative, which is nice. So now if I come back to this expression and inject the value of the induced dipole, then I get an average energy which has a minus sign, a 1/2 because it's an induced dipole, alpha, which is this polarizability, E square. And this is exactly what I need. I have a dipole potential which is proportional to the square of the laser electric field, therefore to the local intensity of the light. If I take alpha negative, that is, if I have a frequency of the light which is above the atomic resonance frequency, if I am on the blue of the atomic resonance, so if alpha is negative, minus alpha here will be positive, so the potential energy here will be larger when the light is large, it will be smaller where the light intensity is small. So if I have a standing wave with node and antinodes, my atom will want to sit at the node of the standing wave because this is where the potential energy will be minimal and it will be larger if the atom tries to go from the node to the antinode. So with that, I can really make a Taylor trap for my atom. If I am able to make a given light pattern onto my atom, I give a given potential landscape to the atom. And in particular, I can give a periodic potential to the atom. So here is a very nice example of an optical lattice which was made by Marcus Greiner in Harvard a few years ago, which is a 2D system. So it's a plane of atoms. The atoms are confined in this plane. I will tell you how to confine an atom in a plane in a moment. These atoms are looked at with a microscope objective. Here, the frequency of the optical lattice was chosen close to the atomic resonance frequency so that you have a lot of spontaneous emission. You can also tune far from the resonance, and then the spontaneous emission rate is much, much lower, which is actually better if you want to preserve the coherence of the matter wave. But here, they wanted to see the atoms one by one. So they tune the frequency of the optical lattice close to the resonance. And in this way, each atom scatters light, and each point here is a single atom. So if some of you had a doubt about the atomic hypothesis, the atoms do exist. Okay, we have an example here. And actually, these atoms, you can see them moving like that. So if you look carefully, the movie is looped. If you look carefully, you can see that the atoms are moving more along vertical lines. Some are moving horizontally, but more on vertically. It's simply because the energy barrier from one side to the other along the vertical direction is lower, so this motion is favored. And you can also see that you lose some atoms because over 1 second, which is the duration of the movie, some atoms have been hit by a molecule of the gas. I mean, the vacuum is not perfect in the vacuum chamber, so there are still some molecules of oxygen or nitrogen which can remove the atom from those traps. Okay, so we have optical lattices, periodic systems, periodic potential for the atom, and this can form a very good model system for electricity conduction. Why is it so? So why can we hope to have our atoms in this laser standing wave to mimic the way an electron moves, say, in a crystal like this? At first, it's not going to work well because there are many energy orders of magnitude difference between the electron which is here and the atom which is there. But as you will see, in the end, it works out well. So let me compare some numbers. The distance between sites. If I take a crystal, typical distance between two sites, 3 angstrom, typically. Here, typical distance is lambda over 2, where lambda is the wavelength of light, distance between two nodes. Lambda over 2 is, say, 0.3 micrometers. Okay, so I have 3 orders of magnitude here. If I compare the mass, here I have an electron, here I have an atom. If I take an atom like rubidium, atomic mass close to 100, so I have 5 orders of magnitude, the difference between electron and the atom. Okay, so it's not similar. If I compare the temperature, here I'm 300 K, here I'm nanokelvin domain, so I have 11 orders of magnitude, not doing so well. But now, if you look at the double wavelengths, so you have to compare, I remind you, the wavelengths is h divided by m, the mass times the velocity. So you use the mass and the velocity in terms of temperature. Now you find out that the double wavelength here is something like 3 nanometer, and here it will be 3 micrometer with these values. And now the important parameter, as usual in physics, we should always go to dimensionless parameters. The relevant parameter in this case is lambda over d, that is the ratio between double wavelengths and the period of the lattice. So it's lambda over d, and equivalently, if you are from condensed matter, you will use kBT over the Fermi energy. This ratio, lambda over d, is the same on this column and on that one, because I have 3 orders of magnitude for d, but I also have 3 orders of magnitude for lambda. So lambda over d is the same. Fermi temperature is the same. So indeed, by looking at what happens for this system, I can have some information on what could happen for an electron in the same periodic pattern. So if it is just a sinusoidal periodic pattern, there is not much to be learned. But you understand that since I can engineer this periodic pattern, that I can go beyond simply the simplest case. And one major result in this framework is what was obtained in Munich in 2001 by the group in the group of Emmanuel Bloch, which is the fact that they could, by changing the height of the barrier between two adjacent sites here, they could see an interaction-driven transition, phase transition, between a MOT insulator and a conductor. The conductor was simply a superfluid state where the atom could move freely from one side to the other. The MOT insulator was the fact that actually this configuration, where you have two atoms on the same side, was forbidden because it costs too much energy to put one atom on the top of each other. He was in a situation where the interactions were repulsive, so there is some energy cost to make that. And so when you vary the height of the barrier between two sides, there is a threshold above which you don't want to do this anymore. It costs too much energy. You prefer to have one atom on each side, and so you have an insulator that do not move freely. When you are not yet at this threshold, then you have a superfluid state. And they could see this phase transition for bosons, and that was really a kind of signal for many people that indeed with this cold atom system we could address non-trivial effects of condensed matter, non-trivial macroscopic effects. Okay, something that I mentioned also in my checklist was the fact that if we really want a quantum simulator, we should be able to tune the dimensionality of the system. That is not only play with 3D systems, but also with 1D system or 2D systems, where there are some important questions. So this will be the topic of the seminar of this afternoon. So it's just a kind of advertisement for what you will see in the afternoon. This is about how to do two-dimensional physics with quantum atomic gases. This is something on which we have worked a lot in Paris over the last 10 years, which is how to make a 2D system. So again, we use light. We use light to freeze the motion along one direction, which is a vertical direction. So actually, we squeeze our atomic gas between two light sheets, like that. So here you have the two light sheets in green here. Again, we are in a situation where the dipole energy, the dipole potential that I was introducing before, is such that the atom prefer to stay where there is no light. So the atom wants to stay between the two light sheets. They don't want to go inside the light sheet. So we have, by squeezing this, we have a sheet of atom here, one plane of atom. And then this raises some interesting question, because when you are in reduced dimensionality, in principle, you have no boson chain condensation. This is a so-called Mermin-Wagner theorem. I will review it in the afternoon. But still, there is a superfluid transition, so this is something that we have been addressing.
How do you make the light sheets?
So actually, we prepare the laser in a mode, which is a Hermite-Gauss mode. So it's a mode where you have a nodal plane. Instead of having a laser which is like this one, which is maximal at the center, and the intensity decays from the center, here it's really a mode which has two lobes, and no light in the middle. So it's engineering of the light mode.
So you actually get the two sheets?
Yes, you get the two sheets at the same time. Yes, exactly. And so you may ask what happens in the XY plane. So here again, we use this dipole potential to make some arbitrary geometry. Here you have example of a flat box for the atom. So we have another laser beam coming from the top here. On this laser beam, we put a mask which blocks the light, and we make an image of the mask onto the atoms. So again, the atom wants to go where there is no light because they are repelled by the high intensity region. So if we take a mask which is a square here, we have a dark square in the middle of some light, and so the atom will want to stay inside the dark square, and then you realize a dark square like this, exactly similar to the quantum well that you would realize for electrons in condensed matter physics. You can make circles, you can make targets like this. If you come this afternoon, you will see why this can be interesting and amusing. Okay. Last part of this talk, which is magnetism. What is the point here? As I said before, we want to make a universal quantum simulator. We want to be able to address any problem that can be raised in condensed matter physics, at least any simply formulated problem. And among these problems, quantum Hall effect is certainly a major source of problems. So we would like to simulate magnetism, orbital magnetism. How can we do that since our atoms are neutral particles? So fortunately, there are ways to circumvent that. One way is to rotate the system. So again, we have this force F equal QV cross B for a charged particle in a B field. Q is zero for our atoms. How can we have such a force in spite of the fact that Q is equal to zero? And as I said, rotating the system is a nice way to do it, simply thanks to the Coriolis force. I think you have all heard about Coriolis force. When you go in a rotating frame, you have two forces which appear in a rotating frame. One is a centrifugal force, which is not so interesting. It's simply a harmonic potential, expelling harmonic potential. Don't care so much about it. But you have the Coriolis force. The Coriolis force, this mathematical structure, is F equal to M V cross omega. Omega is a rotation vector. M is the mass of the particle. And when you look at this, V cross omega, it's exactly the same mathematical structure of V cross B. So you can make a one-to-one mapping of the properties of a charged system under a magnetic field and a neutral system in a rotating frame. But the cyclotron frequency Q over M is simply replaced here by QB over M, excuse me, is replaced by omega and so on. So you have a one-to-one mapping between the two. And a nice example of this one-to-one mapping is what you can see when you take a Bose-Einstein condensate and you rotate it. What you see appearing is a vortex lattice, a triangular vortex lattice like the one which is shown here. And this vortex lattice has exactly the same structure, the same mathematical properties as the vortex lattice that you get for a charged system, a superconductor, when you place it in a magnetic field. You get an Abrikosov lattice, and this is the same thing, so to speak, that as what you get for your atoms in a rotating superfluid BC. So the first way to simulate a magnetic field, which has been very successful up to now, is to rotate the system. But it's not the only one. There are other ways, more general, to simulate a magnetic field, and I would like to end by that. These other ways are based on the so-called Aronoff-Bohm phase, which is the quantum version of the Lorentz force. The Lorentz force, QV cross B, is classical. This is what we learn in high school when we have a classical charge in a magnetic field. But the quantum version of the Lorentz force is the Aronoff-Bohm phase. It tells us that if I take a charged particle in a magnetic field, and if I move this particle along a closed contour like this, this particle will acquire a phase. This phase is composed of two parts. One is a simple dynamical phase, exponential of the energy times time divided by h-bar with an I. This one is well known. It's not due to magnetic field. But the other one is a geometrical phase. It's a phase which depends only on the shape of the contour, and more precisely, it depends on the flux of the magnetic field B along this contour. So this geometric phase is, as I said, just the quantum counterpart of the classical Lorentz force. So once you have understood that, you can think of other ways to create a geometric force on your atoms. And if you are able to create a geometric force on, a geometric phase on your atoms, then this geometric phase can be a way to mimic the Aronoff-Bohm phase and therefore to mimic magnetism. And again, the interaction of an atom with light gives us a window for generating such phases. If I take an atom which is in ground state, G, when this atom absorbs a photon and goes into the excited state, and back to the first slide I have shown in this lecture, the atom goes from ground to excited. But now if I look at this in a more quantum way, I have psi G of R, which is a wave function describing the center of mass of the atom when it is in the ground state G. Then when the atom has absorbed a photon, the center of mass wave function is psi E of R, which is simply psi G of R times E to the I phi of R, and this phi of R is just the phase, the local phase of the laser beam. That is, when I absorb a photon, I print on the atom the local phase of my laser beam. And if I can arrange geometries where, by printing this local phase like that, if I take a closed contour, I have something which is non-zero as a geometric phase, then I'm in a good situation to mimic magnetism. So this is a field which is developing very rapidly. There are some side research related to that, which is generating spin orbit couplings, generated not only U1 field that is mimicking electromagnetism, but also mimicking non-abelian gauge field. It's a bit more involved, but it can also be done. I will simply give two or three examples of what can be done here. One thing that people are working on is trying to mimic magnetic field on a lattice. The idea here is to take a square lattice like that one, a 2D square lattice, and to mimic the fact that if we place a charged particle in such a lattice and with a magnetic field which is, say, perpendicular to the board here, you will have some flux of the magnetic field in each cell of the lattice, and therefore if you have a particle which travels along the side of a lattice like that, this particle will acquire the Aronoff-Bohm phase, which will be simply proportional to the flux of the magnetic field through a unit cell of the lattice. What is quite fascinating with this problem is that even at the single particle level, the results are very non-trivial. This is a famous picture, so-called Hofstadter butterfly, which was obtained by Hofstadter more than 40 years ago now, which is a single particle spectrum of a charge moving in such a configuration, that is, moving on a lattice, jumping from one side to the other. So it's a tight binding approximation, so the particle can jump from one side to the other. But when it makes a closed loop like this, it has acquired a phase phi. So when you look at this spectrum, if the flux is zero, you are on this line here. So here, there is nothing special. You get simply the energy band, which is the width between 8J. J is a tunneling matrix element between two adjacent sites. But when you put a non-zero flux, then you have a fractal structure for the single particle spectrum. Say if you take phi here equal 1/3, which could be here, you see that the band, initial band, which was between -4J and +4J, is fragmented into three subbands, this one, that one, and that one. And if you take 1/4, you get 4 subbands, and so on. So it's a very rich spectrum, and the idea is to try to use cold atom system to try to see some aspects of this spectrum. I should say that this is very difficult to see the spectrum for a standard electron in a standard crystal. Because if you take a standard crystal, this size is simply a few angstrom, as I already said. And if you take a magnetic field, which is a standard magnetic field on Earth, that is a few tesla, maybe 20 tesla at most, then the flux phi here is much smaller than the quantum of flux phi zeros I have introduced here. I didn't give the value, but it's simply a function of Q and H, the Planck constant and the charge of the electron. So it means that for a standard crystal, you are always very close to the zero flux limit here. So it's not possible with a standard crystal, an electron in a standard magnetic field, something that can be realized on this planet, it's not possible to explore the whole structure, yeah, because we are limited to small value. Whereas with cold atoms, in principle, with this, the way I've described before of inducing some geometric phases with laser beams, we can in principle explore all these diagrams, and I hope that soon we will have a good mapping of that. So there are many groups working in this field nowadays. This is an example again of a of quantum matter, but this I can skip. And I would like to finish by this, because I think this is a nice challenge for the future, which is a combination of artificial magnetism, assuming we can make it work very well in our labs, and low dimensionality, that is 2D physics. And the topic I want to discuss now is new statistics. Here, what I would like to come back on is the notion of bosons and fermions that I already addressed, but I would like to come back to this in a different manner. Let me take two particles again, and let me make a single exchange of these particles. So I take the particle which is on the right here and put it on the left. Then I can always translate the two to come back to the initial situation. When I make this exchange of two particles like this, I know that I have a system which has the same property as the initial system. So if I started from a state which was not degenerate, oh, there should be a psi here. I know that I have not changed the physical property of the system, so the initial state of the system psi is transformed into something which is simply a phase factor into the I theta times psi. All the psi's are missing, I'm sorry. So you should mentally put a psi here into the I theta times psi. Now let me make a double exchange. So the particle which was on the right, that I've put on the left, I put it back on the right, like this. So since one exchange gives me a theta, the second exchange gives me 2 theta. Now, if I am in a three-dimensional world, like the world in this room, the double exchange part that I've made like this can always be continuously transformed into zero. That is, I can always take my loop, go above the plane, and shrink this loop to zero like this. Which tells me that actually the 2 theta that I have introduced here should be equal to 1. Because if I make zero loop, I don't do anything to the state of the system. Which means that the e to the I theta should be equal to +1 or -1. So the message here is that in a 3D world, this can be made much more accurate and much more rigorous. In a 3D world, there can only be bosons or fermions. That is, there can be only plus sign or minus sign, where I change 2 particles. This is the only option for the e to the I theta that I have here. I am not proving at all the spin statistic theorem. I'm not telling you which particles are bosons, which particles are fermions. I'm just telling you that the 2 options are bosons or fermions. Now, if you are in a 2D world, this notion of going above the plane and shrinking the loop to zero has no meaning. If I'm in a 2D plane, if I live in a 2D world, if I live in a plane, once I have made this loop, the loop is made, and I cannot undo it unless I do just the reverse transformation. So in 2D, there is no constraint on e to the I theta, and there is a continuous range of statistics which is possible. That is, in a 2D world, in principle, you don't have only boson or fermion, but you can have anything between, and this anything between was called by Vilcek in 82 anions. And the place where these anions are supposed to be present are in the presence of orbital magnetism. And that's why it's so important to be able to place our cold gases in a reduced dimensionality, in 2D, and also induce on these 2D gases some artificial magnetism. Because if we can do both, then hopefully we will be able to address the existence of these anionic quasi-particles that should exist in this world. So this has not been done yet at all with cold gases, but it's a nice outlook. So I close with 2 slides of perspectives. First slide is about the first part of the talk, single atom physics, clocks, gravimeters, what we can call in the generic world space-time sensors. As we have seen, now it works very well. This is really at the stage of industrial production. There are startup companies which have been introduced in many places, in many countries. We will soon have, in 1 year from now, some cold atom clocks in space, which will provide this universal time reference. Hopefully, we will go to optical clocks soon, which with a transition in the visible rather than the microwave. Something which is more futuristic, but which is really a very nice challenge for experimentalists, is to go not only to optical clocks, but to go to nuclear clocks. So it's kind of futuristic, but it would be to use a laser to induce some transition inside the nucleus. So usually, transition in the nuclei are more in the mega electron volt regime, So we don't have any mega electrovolt laser. But there are some nuclei where you can have transition which could be addressed with some existing lasers. That would be fantastic because the nucleus is very isolated from the surrounding. So if we could do use some transition in a nuclei like this, that would be clocks with a precision even better than everything I mentioned in my talk. There are some fundamental measurements done with cold atoms, in particular in the spirit of defining new standard for masses. This is something that we will hear about probably in the near future. And also, of course, this is the direct spirit of this school, but other people have addressed this in their lectures. These cold atoms are good tools for quantum information processing, can be qubits formed by atoms in optical lattices, array of microtraps, and there is also the idea of playing with dark states and electromagnetically induced transparency. At the many body level, there are many studies about equation of state of quantum fluids. So these are studying the equilibrium state of quantum fluids, where you look at density as a function of some thermodynamic variables, where you can work either in the ideal gas limit, unitary limit, reduce dimensionality. You can play with disordered potential. You can play with quantum Hall effect, as I've said. You can even go to non-abelian gauge fields. And also something that I will briefly describe in the talk of this afternoon. There is this idea that you can use these cold atom systems to go to study beyond equilibrium physics, out of equilibrium physics. In particular, Kibble-Zwick type physics, what happens when you cool very fast the system across phase transition, then you can generate some topological defects, which are quite interesting, which reveal some dynamical aspects of the phase transition. I will not go through everything, but something which is also very challenging and which will develop certainly in the near future is to combine this many-body physics that you have seen and dissipation. That is, use laser light, intelligent dissipation, controlled dissipation induced by laser light to engineer many-body physics. That is, you should engineer the reservoir to prepare at will, so the many-body system into some exotic states that could not be reached by standard thermodynamic equilibrium. And that's also very interesting. And the last point, which I didn't address in this talk, but which is also very interesting, is to extend everything I've described today about atoms to molecules. This is done in some labs, and there are lots of progress which are done every year now. The field which is open now is ultra-cold quantum chemistry. How do these ultra-cold molecules interact with each other, recombine, and so on? Okay, so with all this, I stop and thank you very much for attention.
Beautiful lecture and a beautiful way to close our quantum information technologies course here in our doctoral program. And I think we have time for quick questions, otherwise we can also talk in the afternoon. Any questions, please repeat the question.
Yes, okay.
I have a question. I have a question about your conclusion. But normally we used to see the difference between of the tubes, of the SUV, because the potentials of pi with different opposing vectors should be the same.
Yes.
So I cannot define the contour of the pi rotation to zero. This I can, but this I cannot. Well, I read that in three dimensions there you should be able to get that you have positives and zeros, but why in two dimensions not the same?
So, your question is?
Is in three dimensions. I cannot. I'm stating that the normal justification between O3 and SU2.
There is no SU2 here, actually. It's O3. It's essentially. O3. Yes, it's O3. Yes. Yes.
But for spin, it's giving SU2. Because when I'm looking for the angular momentum correlations, I find that it is SU2.
Yes, I fully agree that in order to make this reasoning more correct,
I think that conclusion is okay.
Yes, yes,
so.
Yes. No, I perfectly agree with you that the way to make this accurate is a long story. Actually, it comes back to Cécile de Witt in the 60s, where she looked at representation of this indeed full groups and so on. But my point was not so much to prove that there are only bosons and fermions in the 3D space, but more to say that in 2D at least, in 2D,
in 3D does not apply here, as much as...
Yes, well, my point is that when you have done this in 2D, you have done something which is non-trivial.
Yeah.
And this, and that's it. So a double exchange in 2D doesn't have to be identity. That was... This is the main point. Yeah. The fact that a double exchange in 3D is identity, I fully agree with you, is not so trivial. And I think this is your point.
Yes.
That what does it mean, this shrinking? When I say it's identity, that's not trivial. And I was very fast, and I wouldn't reproduce the argument on the board because I don't remember it. I remember reading the paper by Cécile de Witt a long time ago. Yes, yes. I can give you the reference.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Yes. I have a question relating your 2D Bose sequencing.
Yes.
Because the 2D BC feed strength, you can have condensate. Right?
Yes.
But so in your experiment, you don't check along the longitudinal direction at all? Or you put a small trap as well?
We can put a trap. Actually, you are perfectly correct that in the presence, when you have finite size effect, more generally, you can have a BC in 2D. The question is, how does it compete with a superfluid transition which will occur anyway, even for an infinite system? So you have... it's a matter of size. That is, with a finite size system, you always get a BC, but you also have a superfluid transition which is a co-solid solid transition which occurs in an infinite system. So what comes first? How do they relate to each other? This is the difficult question, yes. Which I will address briefly in my talk this afternoon, but if you want to know, to discuss more, I will be very happy, because it's an interesting question.
Actually, I had a question. So what is the challenge of seeing these annual statistics with these cold atom systems? Is it addressing individual atoms or having a pair?
Well, it's first preparing a system where you expect these anionic statistics. So a system like, say, the Laughlin state. And so it's a matter of having a filling factor which is low enough to be in the fractional quantum Hall regime. I will say a word on that in the afternoon, but if I simply come back to this, so here I have already some bosons in a magnetic field, so to speak. But the filling factor is much too large. The filling factor is essentially the number of vortices the ratio between the number of atoms and the number of vortices. And the number of atoms is much larger than the number of vortices. Here you may have something like 50 vortices, or 100 vortices, and you have something like 10 to the 5 atoms. So filling factor is 1,000. So it's a semi-classical state. It's not at all the Laughlin state. For the Laughlin state, you would need 50 vortices and 50 atoms. And then if you have that, you are in good situation to study this anionic physics. So the challenge is to keep the same number of vortices but reduce a lot the number of atoms to go towards interesting fractional quantum Hall states.
Any other questions?
I should have said that Yasser has some papers on this Hofstadter butterfly. So if you have any question on that, which is the slide I showed, you should ask him also.
So if there are no more questions, let us thank, well, first the protocol between the Collège de France and the University of Lisbon, which contributed to your visit, and of course thanks Jean Dalibard for this really beautiful lecture.
Thank you very much.